love this city. Everything about it. Food, culture, heritage, people, or how they complete each other. It's like the city is made for young people to learn and to be creative. In this mesmerizing city, I'm glad to be here.
4 years, Amigong has tried to make a suitable place for their students to feel more enjoyment in their learning process. We believe that learning is not something that the students should do, but it should be something that they want to do. That's why we always support everything that relates to creative and fun learning activities. It is the essential idea of creativity, associating fun and learning all together.
One thing that I love about this university is that they allow us to experiment and try to make new things. It's okay to make mistakes and learn from them. So that's why they built so many facilities, labs, and also they have professional companies. We call it Professional Lab. We can experience what it is like to be in the real industry, what we need to be, the attitude, the skills, and everything that makes us valuable out there. It's like we are well prepared for something big.
When I first got here, I was completely full of worries. Not because of entering a new phase, but about the future. I wasn't sure of what I was supposed to do at that time. But it turns out that everybody does the same. And Amigong made it easier for me. Everybody supports each other. The lecturers, staffs, employees, and all of my friends, they are so lovely. We have sport activities and great facilities. The cafeteria is clean and neat. And the food, they are delicious. We are like coming into a big family.
If you are a person that is afraid of things, I recommend you to come here to feel the atmosphere.
Enjoy the fun with the combination of nature, the city, and romance.
Join us and let this place reveal the best of you.
Come on, join Universitas Amigong Yogyakarta.
Namaku Aji Saka dari negeri Majethi.
Nun jauh di timur ada sebuah negeri yang bertahtakan Ratna Mutumanikam bernama Medang Kamulan. Kemakmuran negeri tersebut kemudian membawa keserakahan bagi rajanya yang bernama Prabu Dewata Cengkar. Di balik kekuasaannya yang tanpa batas, sang raja sangat gelisah dikarenakan adanya ramalan tentang seorang anak bangsa manusia yang kelak akan menaklukkan dan menggantikannya menjadi raja.
Nusantara yang gemah ripah loh jinawi, angkara durjana merusak negari. Penderitaan manusia tak terperi.
Kamu
doa
sudah
dan harapan untuk sang penyelamat bumi.
Pusaka sakti ini aku percayakan padamu. Apapun yang terjadi, jangan pernah kamu berikan pada siapapun, kecuali aku sendiri yang mengambilnya. Jika tidak bersama pusaka itu,
sentikan jauh, Paduka.
Harus menangani perang besar diri sendiri. Kejahatan akan tunduk dan takluk pada jiwa suci yang
Oke, bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Selamat pagi semuanya. Salam sejahtera, namo buddhaya, salam kebajikan. Selamat datang di acara. Ini sudah ditunggu-tunggu ya, setiap bulannya kita ada kolaborasi dengan salah satu kampus yang ada di luar, dan sekali ini dengan UMP Malaysia, dengan judul The Next Level Information Technology. Dan kali ini kita hadirkan dua pembicara yang luar biasa. Yang pertama dari Universitas Amirul Jakarta ada Bapak Dr. Arief Setianto, dan juga dari UMP ada Dr. Verda Ernawan. Nah, sebelumnya saya mungkin mau nyapa dulu nih, Dr. Verda, selamat pagi.
Selamat pagi.
Iya. Apa kabar Dr. Verda?
Alhamdulillah baik di sini.
Iya. Ini Dr. Verda dari Malaysia tapi cakap Indonesianya sangat ini ya, sangat fasih ya, karena beliau orang Indonesia ya.
Indonesia.
So today webinar I think we can mix language between English and bahasa Indonesia and cakap-cakap Malaysia boleh lah ya.
Boleh.
Ya. Dan yang menjadi peserta kali ini banyak dari mahasiswa Universitas Amirul Jakarta dan juga UMP Malaysia. Dan belum bicara kita yang kedua, Bapak Dr. Arief Setianto. Mungkin saya sapa dulu Pak Arief, apakah sudah bergabung? Sepertinya belum ya. Nanti beliau akan join ya. Jadi kali ini kita mau usung tema The Next Level Information Technology. Oh ya, sebelumnya tadi sudah lihat dua video ya. Yang pertama adalah video dari Universitas Amikom Yogyakarta and then video dari Hikayat Ajisaka. Nah, itu adalah film Ajisaka versi 2D, dua dimensi, dan sudah bisa ditonton langsung di Maxstream ya. Jadi teman-teman yang sudah berlangganan Maxstream, silakan bisa nonton Hikayat Ajisaka di sana ya. Baik. Kita akan mulai acara pada pagi hari ini, tapi sebelumnya saya akan bacakan untuk rundown-nya. Yang pertama adalah nanti akan pemaparan yang pertama dari Dr. Verda Ernawan dari University Malaysia Pahang. Beliau adalah senior lecturer di sana dengan topik Cyber Safety and the Quran. Dan nanti saya juga ditemani moderator teman saya, Bapak Satya Abdul Halim Bahtiar. Dan selanjutnya nanti ada langsung kita sambung dengan sesi Q&A. Jadi teman-teman ada di sini boleh tanya, mumpung kita bertemu dengan Dr. Verda nih ya, boleh teman-teman langsung bertanya. Jadi nanti kita ada berikan waktu untuk sesi Q&A. And then yang sesi kedua nanti dengan Dr. Arief Setianto, SSIMT, beliau adalah Wakil Rektor for Cooperation and Development of Amikom University dengan topik Deepfake Detection. Nah, teman-teman pasti udah pernah dengar ya tentang deepfake gitu kan. Itu apa, seperti apa, bahayanya, dan lain sebagainya. Nanti bisa langsung tanya sama Dr. Arief, karena juga ada sesi Q&A, dan kita akan closing sekitar jam 11 siang waktu Indonesia. Ya. Mungkin kalau di Malaysia, 12 p.m. ya. Yeah. Oke. Okay. Yeah. Jadi, teman-teman di sini nanti juga akan dapat sertifikat internasional yang akan langsung dikirimkan ke email masing-masing. Jadi jangan lupa nanti kalau ada staff kami yang mengirimkan link untuk presensi, nanti diisi di sana dan sertifikat internasional akan langsung masuk ke email kalian masing-masing. Oke. Kita akan mulai saja acara pada pagi hari. Tadi saya sudah menyebutkan yang pertama, kita berikan kesempatan kepada University Malaysia Pahang. Nah, sebelumnya Amikom juga sudah berkolaborasi dengan UMP nih ya. Banyak mahasiswa dari UMP itu student exchange ke Amikom. Dan dari Amikom juga mengirimkan beberapa student yang kuliah di sana nih. Yang di sini kalau yang tertarik, semoga besok tahun 2022 sudah bisa melakukan mobility ke luar negeri. Insya Allah semoga semua COVID-19 sudah nggak ada virus lagi, dan kita bisa melakukan mobility outbound ya. Oke, kita akan langsung aja mulai pada sesi yang pertama, yaitu dengan Dr. Verda. Tapi sebelumnya saya akan berikan ke moderator kita, teman saya, Mas Satya Abdul Halim Bahtiar. Selamat pagi, Mas Satya.
Selamat pagi, Kak Rona.
Ya, apa kabar, Mas Satya?
Alhamdulillah, hari ini sangat luar biasa.
Kayaknya udah fresh gitu ya.
Oh, sudah fresh. Terima kasih. Ini karena Kak Rona ini jadi fresh. Tadi okay, masih agak panik dia ya, kan.
Oke, okay, all is well ya Mas Satya. Sekarang saya berikan acara ini kepada Mas Satya.
Oke, okay, terima kasih Kak Rona. Ya, selamat pagi, Dr. Verda.
Ya, selamat pagi, Mas Satya.
Lama nggak ketemu ya, Dr. Verda ya?
Iya.
Ya, ini alhamdulillah kita bisa ketemu lagi online kali ini. Dan acaranya adalah sharing session. Dan yang pertama nanti dengan Dr. Verda. Di sini juga sudah hadir, kalau kata mahasiswa Amikom itu bestinya Dr. Verda. Ini ada Pak Dani di sini. Juga sudah hadir di sini. Gitu. Ini nanti mungkin wah ini sudah ikut on cam Pak Dani. Selamat pagi Pak Dani.
Oke, baik. Selamat pagi Pak Dani.
Ya, baik.
Mari.
Ya, jadi memang salah satu hubungan baik Amikom dengan University Malaysia Pahang juga ada karena Pak Dani ya, karena Pak Dani juga salah satu yang ada di sana menjadi keluarga bagian keluarga dari UMP. Dan itu yang membuat hubungan Amikom terus berkembang di sana. Dan teman-teman, untuk kali ini, seperti yang sudah disampaikan oleh Kak Rona tadi, yang Dr. Verda akan bahas topiknya adalah Cyber Safety and the Quran. Nanti ada 45 menit pemaparan dari Dr. Verda, dan dilanjutkan dengan 15 menit ada mungkin Q&A, sharing session dengan kita semua. Boleh teman-teman nanti disampaikan di kolom chat, atau teman-teman yang ada di YouTube, boleh juga di chat di YouTube, kami tetap akan pantau, karena ini juga di streaming lewat YouTube, nanti di waktu Q&A akan kami sampaikan pertanyaannya. Oke, seperti itu. Dan supaya kita bisa langsung diskusi, nanti akan langsung dijelaskan oleh Dr. Verda tentang cyber safety in the Quran. Dr. Verda, time is yours, please.
Okay, thank you, Mas Satya. So let me, can you see my screen now?
Yeah, I can see it.
So good morning, everyone. Good morning, all students. And good morning, Pak Arif, Vice Director of Amikom University. Let me introduce myself to those who did not know or never know my name at Amikom. My name is, where is my mouse? Okay. My name is Dr. Verda. Yeah, you can call me Verda. And today I'm going to discuss about the cyber safety, but not only cyber safety. I will also discuss about the cyber crime. Okay, and what's the relationship with the Al Quran here? So we will discuss about the security. We will also discuss the crime, the first crime in the paradise, and so on. So basically, I'm also a leader. A head of a research group, SPIN, Software Computing and Intelligence System. And this is my research interest, compression, copyright protection, authentication, and other image processing related in that field. Yeah. Okay, I'm from the Faculty of Computing, as mentioned by Madam Rona. You also can join mobility for next semester. I still remember Amikom has three quota, not three quota, something like deposit in UMP. Still never take the deposit that one. Yeah, so you can go to the search UMP. Yeah. All right. So the outline today. Let me. Minimize like this. We will discuss a crime, security, enemy, okay, and the top threat 2020-2021, okay, and also a little bit discuss about the social engineering and how to mitigate the cyber crime and also the cyber safety tips, yeah, or internet safety tips, yeah. All right. So, any one of you know what is the first crime recorded in paradise? You can raise your hand, or let me give you tips. If you look at the Surat Al-Baqarah ayat 34, We can see di sana diartikan Allah meminta semua malaikat untuk bersujud kepada Nabi Adam. Dan hanya iblis yang tidak mau, ya, tidak ingin sujud terhadap Nabi Adam. He said that they born from the fire. Nabi Adam dari tanah. So something like I can say that something like arrogant. Yeah? So we record it as the first time in the paradise. How about the first ever security breach? So we discuss the security. Tadi kita discuss about the crime, kejahatan yang direcord di dalam surga. Itu disebutkan di salah satunya ada di surat Al-Baqarah ayat 34, ada juga surat Al-A'raf ya, ayat 12 sampai 30. Di situ juga disebutkan ya. How about the first ever security breach in the human history? Any one of you know security breach in the human history yang pertama kali? Pernah dengar? Okay, let me see the chat box ya. Yes, good. Eat buah koldi. Nabi Adam memakan buah koldi. So that one is the first ever security breach in the human history. So karena memakan buah tersebut sehingga diturunkan ke bumi. Ya. How about the this one? Ya. Iblis. Ya. Iblis is our first enemy, musuh ya, musuh kita nomor satu yang perlu dilawan. Kita kadang iblis tuh juga ada di dekat kita, ada di dalam diri kita. Ya. Some criteria inside the iblis criteria such as arrogance. Okay. Kita kadang tidak sadar, kita selalu bilang I am better than you, okay. I am better than him. Actually that one is the one of the criteria arrogance. Yeah. Something it also mentioned in surat Al-A'raf, okay, 11-30. If you read that surat, yeah, Al-A'raf. So one of the criteria of the iblis is arrogance. How about the second one? Ungrateful. Yeah. Tidak pernah bersyukur. You will not find most of them grateful to you. Yeah. So it is also one of the criteria of the iblis. Jadi kalau nggak pernah orang arogan, tidak pernah bersyukur, ini sudah ini harus mulai kita harus mulai introspeksi diri. Deceiving, ya, menipu, membuat so he made them fall through deception, dengan cara menipu, membuat merugikan orang lain. Nah, itu juga termasuk salah satu kriteria daripada iblis. So we have to try to avoid. We cannot avoid, but we try to reduce as much as we can. Yeah, we have to try. And this is the first enemy. So usually it's come from our soul. Something, yeah. Kadang kita nggak sadar, kita arogan. Kadang juga kita nggak sadar kalau kita itu tidak bersyukur. So we have to. I try to remind myself. Okay. So we try to. We hope everyone who attend this lecture then we can think about this criteria. Kita punya kriteria ini atau tidak, dan kita harus memulai untuk bersyukur ya. Okay, so I wanna ask, let me this one ya, ignore ya. Do you know the first time on the earth? You can type into the chat box if you know. Okay. The first time on the earth, do you know the story of the Habil and Qabil? Terjadi pembunuhan, Qabil membunuh Habil. Itu adalah tragedi pertama yang ada di dunia. So I can say that this one is the first crime. So why we are going to discuss a scripty, discuss a crime, okay? But we cannot imagine that the crime dulu saling membunuh, but now we call it cybercrime. So later on we will discuss in detail what kind of the cybercrime, the top threat in the 2020 and so on. So if we refer to the Habil and Qabil, already mentioned in Surat Al-Ma'idah 27-32, if you should raise your hand against me to kill me, I shall not raise my hand against you to kill you. Yeah. Indeed, I fear Allah, Lord of the world. Tahu kriteria Habil, Qabil seperti apa? Dia cerita dari Qabil dengan Habil. Ya, salah satunya mereka menyajikan kurban kepada Allah. Pada saat itu kurban yang dari Habil yang diterima. Then what happened? Qabil jealous, ya, jealous karena dia ingin menikahi dengan saudara kandungnya, sehingga Qabil membunuh Habil. Woman, because of woman. And another one is power. Qabil merasa dirinya paling besar, paling senior. Yeah. So from this story from the Quran, we can say this is the first crime, yeah, in the world, okay, in the human history. Then we have to look at we have to look at ourselves whether we have those criteria or not. If we have it, so start from now, we try to avoid, yeah, tadi arogan, tadi dan seterusnya, jealous, okay, woman power, yeah, we try to as we can, yeah. So the threat in the paradise, lepas itu crime in the world, in the first history of the human, okay. Sekarang apa yang terjadi? 2020, this is the most crime, the most threat, yeah, in 2020 due to the COVID. Everyone online, everyone in front of the computer. You know, the internet user has drastically increased due to the COVID pandemic, okay. And at the same time, the malware, okay, and also the threat, okay, also increase. Such as number one, crypto jacking. Yeah. It's cybercrime that involve unauthorized use of the people device by cybercrime, cyber criminal to mine, yeah, for cryptocurrency. Jadi kalau ada yang suka bermain cryptocurrency, hati-hati dengan crypto jacking. Ada juga software flaw, ada juga software subdivision. Okay, it is a process making the software perform unintended actions such as tampering with the program. Ada juga ransomware. Okay, it is a form of the malware software that infect your system and encrypt the file. Suddenly, your data will be encrypted. So when you open something, like the data is scrambled, so you don't know what happened to my data. You don't realize about the ransomware. Ternyata sudah terinfected ransomware. Jadi data-datanya adik-adik mahasiswa terenkripsi. Phishing. Phishing is a type of the social engineering attack, yeah, often used to steal the user data. Jadi seperti memancing, ya. For example, by clicking the email, maybe you receive that an email, and then something like real official email, and then they encourage you to click hyperlink. Once you click the hyperlink, the malware inject into your system, and then they will get the data, login user, your ATM, banking account, yeah. So that one is phishing. Another one is a botnet. It is a network of the computer infected by the malware that are under control by a single attack, botnet. Ada lagi deepfake. Today, Dr. Arif is going to discuss in deep about the deepfake. Actually, this is the synthetic media with, in which a person, the existing image, is replaced by someone else. So, jadi kayak digantikan dengan gambar yang lain seolah-olah jadi nyata nanti. But we will Dr. Arif will discuss in detail that one. So I'm not going to discuss this topic. How about the other common hacking technique in 2021? Again, due to the COVID-19 pandemic, everyone stay at home. Everyone use the internet, okay? So the most popular in 2021, something like DDoS. You know, it is a technique, it's aimed at taking down a website so that the user cannot access it or deliver their service. And it causes the overload memory or the system, so the user cannot whether want to click something the button, it cannot be happen due to the overload memory. Yeah. Another one is missing security patch. Yeah. So this one, it is a security tool. Yeah, can become outdated as the hacking landscape advance. Yeah. So it occur when the patch especially you never updated, okay? You did not update yet the patch of your system. So there is the hole for the attacker, okay, to go inside into the system. Another one is the malware injection. Okay, use hardware to sneak malware onto your computer. It always happen. For example, your friend, okay, I want to copy some data from your PC, and then you try to plug in your pen drive, flash disk, istilahnya, flash disk. And then what happen when you put the that pen drive into your computer? It can get your access. Yeah. Sometimes it will be duplicate the file. Also can be happen like that. Yeah, they also can insert the malware in order to duplicate the process so that your memory or RAM will be overloaded. And the most popular, yeah, the next popular is a software social engineering attack. Are you aware with it, social engineering, this one? I have a question to you. Can you go to the classpoint.application/join? Please open it now, and then enter this class code. Okay, 81329. I want to see your response. What is the social engineering? Based on your experience, or let's say if you never know, then you can mention I never know, sir, social engineering. Okay, please join classpoint.application/join here. Yeah? Enter class code, this one, 81329. Here I can see around 90 participant, so can I see, can you join now?
Oke, teman-teman silakan untuk bisa join ya di what is the URL? Classpoint.apps.
And this is the class.
Let's join and you can input the number. Teman-teman bisa buka di classpoint.app/join, kemudian di class code teman-teman bisa masukkan 81329.
Ya. Yeah. And then please mention your name, ya.
Yeah. Nah, oke, okay, saya sudah masuk.
Ada Faista, ada Wildan, ada Rijal, oh ada Pak Dani, ada Pak Satya.
Habis silakan teman-teman bisa join, jangan titip absen ya teman-teman ya.
So, ClassPoint can help my presentation to interact to the user, so I can see the real user here, the user who listen the my topic today. Okay, 13, okay, 72, 14. All right, come on. Wah, ada operator Amikom juga. Oke. Okay. 72-20. Oke, okay. Around 30%. Oke okay lah. 24. 25. Oh, oke. Okay. 25. Class full. Alright, sorry. Oke, okay. Then answer my question. What is the social engineering? Based on your experience, what you know, apa itu social engineering? Boleh ditulis. Kalau tidak tahu, saya tidak tahu, sir. But if you know, then mention it.
Silakan ditulis di sebelah kanan. Itu ada tulisan question, short answer. Type your answer in the box below ya. Nanti ada klik submit di sana. Teman-teman bisa submit jawabannya di sana.
Ah, Niza, dia tahu lagi. Menipu memanipulasi orang agar mendapatkan informasi. Oke, okay. Lagi, ada lagi. Saya ingin tahu jawaban masing-masing. Memanipulasi psikologi dari seorang dalam melakukan aksi membuat suatu informasi rahasia. Manipulasi psikologi. Ah, ini. Oke, okay. Engineer tapi bidang sosial. Engineer bidang sosial. Social manipulation. Oke. Okay. Bagi yang menjawab Maulana menjawab a way to trick manipulate the victim in order to get the desired personal data, access information by manipulating the victim in subway. Percakapan antar manusia untuk mendapatkan informasi personal untuk kepentingan orang lain. Kahar menjawab menciptakan suara agar orang mau memberikan informasi tertentu. Afan membongkar sebuah rahasia seseorang. Jawabannya ini ya agak general ya. Trying to get the access of the other people information. Ini phishing bagaimana? Phishing juga try to get access ya other people information. Manipulasi sosial, ada mahasiswi Atin, manipulasi sosial itu yang, oke, okay. Bukan itu ya, tapi ya, and then saya ingin lihat lagi yang ada di sini jawabannya apa aja. Yeah, to influence people into performing certain action, oke. Okay. Manipulasi psikologis orang untuk mencari informasi rahasia tertentu. Social engineering is about technique for the social insensitive. Tindakan yang mengekspos kelemahan seseorang untuk mendapatkan akses. Ini sama, phishing juga sama ya. Exploit technique that exploit human error to gain access to personal information. Oke. Okay. Cara mendapatkan informasi dengan cara menipu pemilik informasi tersebut. Oke. Okay. Ini Pak Dani, manipulate people into supplying information. Oke, okay, so from let me close the session ya. Yeah. close the submission ya. So saya sekarang jadi tahu kira-kira berapa persen daripada audiens saya yang tahu ya, yang aware dengan social engineering. Kurang lebih tadi dari jawaban yang dari mahasiswa yang sampaikan ke saya, kurang lebih 40% masih tidak tahu jawabannya ya. So I hope after this you know about the social engineering ya. So the definition, it is not technical but psychological manipulation. Yeah, those who answer say psychological manipulation. Yes, your answer is correct. Yeah, and another word, okay, it is exploiting the human, not the technology. Yeah. Attack to the human psychology, not the malware technology, the way how to get the data. Yeah. Not like that, yeah. But in terms of technology, but the way to get the data from the human psychology, it may be a simple, it may be a complex. Okay. Example: if you believe a simple email and reply with the information they need, they don't need to install a bug through a malware to get your data. Yeah. Actually, the user will provide the data that they want to you. Jadi kalau mahasiswa semua mudah sekali memberikan informasi without analyzing the email, then actually the attacker doesn't need to send the malware to your system, okay? Because the user will provide it to you. So what kind of the social engineering attack here? Ada yang if you look at the goals, the goals of the social engineering attack is the financial gain, unauthorized access, service disruption, and medium. We can use the email, face to face, telephone, short message service. Nah, sometimes saya saudaranya lagi kecelakaan nih di Kalimantan, tolong isi pulsa. That one is also one of the social engineering attack. Pernah nggak dapat seperti itu? Saya yakin saya sering sekali dapat, walaupun saya di Malaysia, saya masih dapat karena ada nomor Indonesia. Mohon kirim pulsa dong, ini saya saudaranya lagi di ini kecelakaan dan seterusnya. Nah, perasaan saudara saya lagi kerja nih, tapi dapat email seperti itu ya. So social engineering can be individual, also can be a group of individual. Okay. The target can be individual, also can be organization. Sometimes organization can be a target from the attacker here. Compliance and principle, friendship, commitment, security, okay, social validation, authority, and so on. Technique, okay, yeah, they can use the phishing, pretexting, baiting, quite provo, and others. So this is the medium that they can use to convincing the victim, untuk meyakinkan si korban. Boleh melalui telepon, okay. Bisa melalui telepon, okay. Social media, comment, personal message, mostly email, okay. Email, yeah. Message, interaction, WhatsApp, Telegram, yeah. And then phishing web, okay. Scare web. Basically, the attacker will do a research, okay, before they. They communicate to the victim, yeah? And then develop rapport and trust, exploiting the trust, meyakinkan dari korban tadi, victim tadi, okay? And utilize the information, okay? Information from the user. Okay? Maybe you have a question, how did the attackers get my information? So they can get it from the dark web easily. actually the goal of the hacker, okay, there are two. Actually, the, I can classify the two goals. Number one, they wanna sell the information into the dark web to gain the what we call to gain the financial gain. Yeah. Second one, to show the capability, something like they wanna show off. Okay, I can breach that data. I can breach that system easily. Something like ingin menunjukkan kalau dia itu boleh. Biasanya tujuan hacker itu seperti itu. Dia ingin menjual, ya, menjual data daripada korban di dark web, di satu web untuk dijual belikan. Yang kedua, biasanya tujuan dari hacker itu dia ingin menunjukkan bahwa dirinya itu eksis di dunia cyber. And the social engineering elements, urgency, okay, kelangkaan, timbal balik, trust, friendship, commitment, and consistency, and authority. So let me give example. Fraudster obtain the legitimate user info from the dark web. They get the data, your data from the dark web. Fraudster ini yang tadi penipu call the victim, okay, and they pretend to be an official from a bank or the government agency. Mereka akan mencoba menelpon korbannya, kemudian mengirimkan menelpon misalnya dari saya dari bank gitu, dari government agency, okay. Apakah benar saya berbicara dengan nama Pak Mas Satya, apa benar nih nomor rekeningnya? Kemudian fraudster convince the victim that there is an urgent need to fund transfer. Biasanya, Pak ini kalau mau dapat hadiah harus segera transfer dulu nih Pak. Kurang lebih 500 nanti Bapak dapat hadiah 1 juta, 10 juta misalnya. And then the fraudster try to convince the victim to log into their bank account. Okay. Fraudster dictate instruction to the victim on the detail of the transfer, payment, amount, and so on. And then finally, the victim, the korbannya selesai mentransfer. Dia percaya, gitu. Percaya dengan komunikasi yang baru saja yang tadi. Sometimes not only within not occur within a certain period, but maybe it can 2 days, 3 days within a certain period in order to convince the user, yeah, the victim, yeah. So another social engineering technique is a phishing, something as stealing other personal information by leading them to the fake web page but look legit. Kalau dapat email, biasanya dapat email gitu. Email itu seolah-olah sama seperti dengan misalnya Bank Mandiri, gitu, website Bank Mandiri. Saya pernah lihat website Bank Mandiri hanya berbeda domain name. Gitu. Kemudian emailnya hampir menyerupai dari daripada bank, oke? Okay. Then they encourage the user to click hyperlinks. Don't do that one. Eh? It's very dangerous. They can get the they can send the what we call the malware. Yeah. At Malaysia, okay, among the website that were frequently manipulated were internet banking page. Kalau di Malaysia paling banyak itu internet banking fraud daripada internet banking. Saya sering kali dapat daripada pajak, kalau di sini hasil LHDN dari Kuantan biasanya dia telepon, sometimes telepon dari ke saya, sometimes dia email saya. Minta maaf Dr. Feda, Encik, you still did not pay the tax and so on. Hah? Saya angkat, saya layanin. Oh okay. Tapi kalau saya lagi sibuk, saya matikan. I know that one is the what we call attacker that use social engineering technique. Karena dalam hati saya selalu pajak saya selalu dibayarkan dari UMP. Jadi kenapa saya harus bayar pajak? Jadi ini ini orang enggak tahu. So kalau ada waktu dilayanin, tapi you have to know, you have to aware, okay? That one is they are from attacker, yeah. So they use a social engineering to influence, to convincing the victim to send the money to get the profit from you, yeah. Okay, Google Threat Analysis Group reported it has detected and blocked around 18 million phishing attempts and malware sent with the term of the COVID-19 every day. Dapat email COVID-19, minta tidak sumbangkan. Sebenarnya minta sumbangkan itu atas nama misalnya panti asuhan, tapi sebenarnya bukan masuk ke panti asuhan, tapi masuk ke rekening pribadi atau organisasi tadi. And 90% of the cyber attack occurred were related to the phishing 2016, yeah. Enterprise phishing susceptibility report of the phishing. Okay. Contoh nih scam teknik by impersonation kepercayaan. It has happened in Malaysia many times during the COVID-19 pandemic. Okay. Attacker tuh kalau lihat dari brochure like this, okay, you can see that the contact person ada dua nih, Mira, Nadia. Attacker tuh pasti akan berpikir, they will think that Mira is closer to the Nadia, is a friend of the Nadia. So attacker will try to communicate to the Mira, this one, yeah. Have a look this one. And this is the contact number, Mira, and this is Nadia. Attacker will try to contact Mira as they something like they say to Mira that okay, Mira, saya Nadia gitu. Tetapi nomornya saya baru ganti nomor nih. Saya Nadia bla 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 bla. Mira, saya barusan ganti nomor gitu. Can you get the info? Can you send the info? Yang Nadia tidak tahu sebenarnya, tapi Mira mendapatkan message daripada someone else, but seolah-olah itu adalah Nadia. Then they will get the information, and if Mira trust to that person, okay, to the attacker, yes, of course, all the information, financial will be transferred. So be careful when you mentioning two contact number in the brochure. It can be happen like that. It was happen in Malaysia. They take some profit from the one of the brochure from workshop something like this. Okay, again, go to the because this is the limited. Okay, only 25. Participant can join, right? So I have a question to 25 participant. Okay, have you been attacked with any of the technique phishing scam technique by impersonation? You can answer it. Lagi ada 24 lagi. Wow, scam teknik by impersonation. Phishing tidak pernah. Baru 10. Ada lagi? 20 lagi mahasiswa tadi. Hari ya? 10? Other student? Oh, okay. Alright, so I can see the most of the student, okay, from 25, yeah. I have a limited account here, only 25. So only 10 student has experience. Oh, 5. Yeah, kissing, pernah dapat. Pernah diterima, ya. Yeah. Okay. Okay, let me close, ya. Yeah. So I can assume that from the 15 student, 10 student, oh, again, increase, ya. Yeah. 10 student receive attack by scam technique by impersonating, ya. Yeah. Let me close again. So be careful, yeah. So you have to aware. Okay. How to mitigating cybercrime? Okay. Number one, increase knowledge and security measure. If you know that kind of the type of the cybersecurity or top threat 2020, top threat 2021. You know the definition, you know about the how they are performing, how they send the malware, how they send the attack, okay? Then it can help you to protect. Increasing knowledge and the security measure. Second, create awareness, not become a victim. Jangan jadi korbannya, ya. Kalau mau jadi korban, tapi kalau knowledge-nya tahu, oke, okay, yang tadi, seperti tadi ada yang telepon saya, itu dari pajak, gitu. Ini saya dengarkan, dengarkan aja kalau ada waktu, ya. But create awareness is important for you to avoid, become a victim, ya. Fight your real enemy. Musuh yang nyata itu sebenarnya Satan and his aliens. Maksudnya di sini adalah kalau mahasiswa tahu cara dibuat DDoS, cara membuat malware injection, okay, misalnya, then you have to fight your real enemy from your soul, not become a Satan. Then if you know that knowledge, okay, you know how to attack, okay, don't do that one because it give a lost profit to the victim. So jangan buat. Kalau sudah tahu cara buat DDoS, kemudian mau nyoba-nyoba iseng dibuat temannya, itu temannya merasa rugi, jangan dibuat. Kalau mau tes, teslah di komputernya sendiri. So don't be a Satan, ya. So kalau sudah tahu knowledge-nya, tahu cara membuat malware dan seterusnya, jangan buat. Clean heart movement, ya. Gerakan hati bersih. Bukan maksudnya kita mencuci hati gitu, enggak seperti itu, ya, maksudnya mengambil hati kemudian di, kita bukan not a criminal, but clean heart movement is gerakan hati bersih. Jadi kalau hati kita bersih, kita knowledge kita tinggi, kita tahu bagaimana cara membuat, we will not do that much. Okay. But you know how to protect your friend, your family, and your colleague. Clean heart is illuminated with a good thought toward all. Hati yang bersih disinari dengan pikiran yang baik untuk semua, tidak hanya untuk saudara dan yang seiman, ya, but untuk semua. Kalau hatinya bersih, pasti akan disinari dengan pikiran yang baik untuk semua. Jadi kita akan berpikir yang baik untuk semua orang. Tidak perlu membeda-bedakan, oh ini seiman dengan saya, so saya akan, hati saya akan baik ke seiman, enggak, tapi untuk semua, walaupun berbeda agama, then we have to berpikiran baik untuk semua orang. The way, clean your heart, yeah. Of course, if your heart become, your heart is bersih, baik, pikiran juga kan, baik, tidak akan melakukan DDoS, malware, dan seterusnya, ya. Protect your heart from Satan, from the iblis, tadi yang kriteria tadi, arogan dan seterusnya. You have to protect. Kalau if you don't protect it, you know the knowledge, then you become a hiker. So you will attack. You will get the profit. You want to show I am a power. I have a knowledge. I can breach the system. I can goes to inside the system. It become like this. You will become hiker. So, but if you protect your heart, clean heart movement, I believe you will not do that one. Whether you have knowledge to do that one. So how about the cyber safety, internet safety tips? Can give you some tips to you in order to protect. Number one, update. Okay, always update your mobile device. It's something like vaccine. Yeah. So the manufacturer will always strive to protect their customer. Okay. They will encourage the user to update. If any notification update from Windows, example, then you need to just update it. You have to spend your time to update it. Yeah, don't avoid to update. Yeah. Jadi kalau ada firewallnya mau minta update, ya segera diupdate saja. Okay, karena basically by default manufacturer perusahaannya akan mencoba memprotek semua user. Yeah, so update like a vaccine. If you don't update, maybe the latest malware can inject, whether you already install the firewall, antivirus, and so on. So if antivirus request to update, then you have to update. Second one, you can use, you can go to the virustotal.com here in order to check whether your mobile device already has attempt to attack or not. And also you can check your Gmail. Yeah, you can go to the monitor, the firefox.com. You can see how many attacker attempt to your Gmail. And you also can go to the haveibeenpwned.com. Okay. Then you can see the if read like this, there is a 3 data breach and found 1 place. If green, none. Huh? And lastly is the install the application from the Play Store and Apple Store, especially for mobile. Eh? For mobile apps, I can suggest it to you. Install from the Google Play Store or Apple Store. I never use install the APK one unless you made it by yourself. Yeah, then okay. So Apple and Google Play Store are sources of the application that has been monitored by Android and Apple. All right, that's it from me. Thank you so much for listening. You may email me for any inquiry to the www.bmp.edu.my. Thank you so much.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Feda, for your presentation. Okay, so we will going to Q&A session, and I will let the student, if there is any question, they can ask in the chat. Kalau teman-teman ada pertanyaan, kita sudah masuk ke sesi tanya jawab, teman-teman bisa sampaikan ya di kolom chat ataupun di YouTube, silahkan komen di kolom komen, nanti kami akan sampaikan ke Dr. Verda. Menarik tentang cyber safety ya. Kalau di Indonesia sendiri, dokter, yang agak unik adalah we found a lot of social engineering method in Instagram. The unique list, something like that. Ada fitur namanya apa ya? Drop yours atau apa gitu ya. Jadi pertanyaan gini, sebutkan variasi namamu, gitu kan. Okay. Give your name of variation, gitu kan. Disebutlah, nah. Ada orang yang unaware person gitu, dia nyebutin A, B, C, D, E, itu nama-namanya. The more unaware person, more specific. My mother call me X. My friend this call me this. My friend this call me this. And their friend get a message. Aku si X. Minta pulsa dong, tolong kirimin ini. Dan mereka nggak sadar. Mereka unaware kalau itu adalah salah satu metode social engineering. And also, I found the maybe it's funny. I afraid I say something bad ya. Karena ini ke kalau mereka sampai nggak tahu, masa nggak tahu gitu. Jadi ada satu isu. Jadi giveaway method. Giveaway method. Giveaway method. You can get 10 billion rupiah. Wow, gitu kan? So the regulation is just so easy. Put your photo with your ID. Cling. With your ID. And then what happened? Dia dapat tagihan pinjol.
That one is one of the social media attack.
Yeah. So they just, what is that? I get some maybe a credit payment, tapi mereka nggak merasa pinjam, gitu kan? They don't think I don't apply for some loan, I don't apply for some credit, but when they ask me to pay, gitu, they don't know if they put the photo with the ID, make maybe the security of their personal ID it get through, get friends. Jadi memang Instagram cukup banyak ya, karena sekarang banyak anak muda dan unik-unik gitu. Oke, mungkin untuk mengawali pertanyaan Dr. Verda, it's about security, ada isu ya, ada isu berkaitan dengan antivirus. Nah, ini banyak basic question for many student, many people maybe. They access. First is, what is the best antivirus? Apakah saya butuh? What is it? I need antivirus? Because some people say that virus is made by who own the antivirus. It's look the ISO pandemic, right? China who made the virus, so they get the vaccine. So it's also issue in antivirus in technology. What do you think about that?
Antivirus, okay. For me, antivirus is subjective. Okay, something like brain. Okay, if you like Honda, then you have to buy a Honda. If you like Toyota, then you buy a Toyota. Same like antivirus. If you like Kaspersky, then you buy a Kaspersky. Then my suggestion is to you, just use the reputable antivirus. That's it, and always update it. So all the antivirus is good. Avira, Kaspersky, and others. Okay, it is a subjective. The most important thing is always update it. So it can protect your computer from the virus and also the malware.
But is it mandatory? In your opinion?
In my opinion, antivirus is compulsory. And especially the firewall should be active. If you have antivirus but your firewall is deactivated, yeah, of course there are a lot of way to attack your computer. So my suggestion, firewall and antivirus should be installed and updated. But again, not only all the technical system like that. If you are the hacker, let's say there is a student here join, maybe one of you the hacker, you know how to create the DDoS, you know how to create the malware, how to inject. So it should come from you, okay? Do you want to become a Satan or Iblis? Or you want to protect you try to clean your heart. You know the knowledge, but if you know the knowledge, then look at your soul, then your heart. You want to clean your heart, you want to be hacker, or you want to be a good person. If you want to be a good person, then you have to clean your heart. Okay. Try to avoid the Satan criteria. Before my topic today, something like cyber security or cyber safety with Al-Quran. So back to the ourself, what we want to be, yeah? Something like that.
Okay, don't fall into the sin. Yeah, the first sin is pride. If you pride of your power, you can do anything. So you used to maybe criminal, it will be dangerous. Okay, that's good. Oke, okay. Any question teman-teman? Ada pertanyaan pakai bahasa Indonesia? Oke.
Okay. Boleh, ya. Bahasa boleh.
Pak Ferdes, tadi,
kalau tadi ada interrupt pun boleh ya, waktu ya, presentation saya, boleh di interrupt sebenarnya.
Oke, okay, oke. Okay. Baik, baik. Ini menarik sebenarnya ya, tentang bagaimana we protect ourselves gitu. Kadang-kadang mahasiswa, student problem is we want to protect our laptop, our computer. We want to buy antivirus, but we think, wah, I don't have money for buy license for antivirus. But that they forget is some student use a one password for all. We find something like that is maybe in lot of student. Jadi satu password untuk semua ya, email, sosial media. Itu kalau menurut Dr. Veda, seberapa penting sih we have lot of password apa ya, combination gitu. Atau sah-sah aja kalau aku punya satu password untuk semua account-ku gitu.
To avoid the data breach. Nah, tadi kan datanya dibobol gitu. We have to use the different character, different symbol, and the length of the password, of course. One account, one password is suggested, yeah. Because if one password for all, again, if you are a big person, you are the important person, okay, easily to get the data, all data, easily for the attacker to conduct this social engineering again. Yeah. So social engineering attack. So very dangerous, especially if you are a big person, you have a lot of money, and then you use one password for all. But for the student, okay, try to learn, try to get knowledge. Ya, tadi ya, ilmu yang bermanfaat, jangan ilmu yang membuat victim, membuat korban. So back to our herd. So I can suggest this use the different password for different account or different platform.
Okay, different password for different account. But I think it's difficult, right? We have so many account, drive account, social media account, any portal account.
I have one tips. Maybe create one a file. Okay, your file consists of the username and password. Okay, and the hyperlink. Okay, but you need to encrypt it. You need to encrypt one file. That file. Okay, create one file and then put your username and the password. Okay. And the domain, the hyperlink. Yeah. After that, you encrypt that file. You just only memorize only one password.
Okay.
If you want to open, for example, Instagram, then open the encrypted file. Okay. After that, you can copy and password, and username and password. That one is make it more easier.
Yeah. I did that. Yeah, I have. I tried to make some password for some account, but unluckily I can't remember all of them. So I did what you said, doctor. I create a file, a link. Saya bikin sebuah link isinya password saya, dan saya terapkan pola. Okay, saya terapkan pola enkripsi di masing-masing itu, dikasih apa, diacak atau seperti apa itu. It's membantu sih, sangat membantu. Yeah. Okay, thank you tipsnya dokter. Jadi teman-teman kalau yang masih punya satu password untuk semua akun, hati-hati karena satu hilang semuanya ya. Teman-teman bisa seperti yang dokter Veda sarankan tadi, bisa buat sebuah file atau sebuah catatan yang isinya password teman-teman, dan teman-teman bisa encrypt. Caranya encrypt gimana? Terapkan pola encryption gitu ya, bisa huruf-huruf tertentu diganti atau ditambahkan sesuatu, atau polanya terserah teman-teman, atau berapa dari berapa huruf dikembalikan ke belakang dan lain-lain. Itu teman-teman bisa mengenkrip sendiri passwordnya. Jadi kalau lupa passwordnya, buka file itu, teman-teman, oh iya passwordku yang ini. Jadi satu account dengan account yang lain punya berbeda password. Oke, teman-teman ada yang mau ditanyakan dulu? Saya coba cek di YouTube. Terima kasih dokter, sangat bermanfaat. Oh, terima kasih Kak Riza. Ya, dari YouTube komen. Oke. Ada lagi kira-kira teman-teman? Berkaitan dengan social engineering tadi ternyata banyak juga ya yang kena gitu. If we talk about the next presentation of Dr. Arif will talk about deepfake, right, Pak Verda? Kalau deepfake, apakah juga banyak social engineering menggunakan itu, Pak?
Oke. Deepfake biasanya untuk membuat illusion, something like copy the others, someone else into the picture, something like look reels. Yeah, it can be happen, but in Malaysia, usually, most probably in Malaysia, they use email and call. They prefer email and call, because if they want to use the deepfake, in Malaysia, not popular, because, you know, deepfake, there is a one technique to get the information by replacing the object, the image or the video and so on. But sometimes it happen. For example, ada last 2 weeks I still remember last week ada orang yang penting di daerah kami gitu. Kemudian ada disebarkan video. Kalau video ini mereka tidak membayar, video ini akan disebarkan. Sedangkan video tersebut sebenarnya bukan video yang asli. Dia ganti muka orang itu untuk video sesuatu yang buruk, kemudian mengancam untuk disebarkan. Itu salah satu deepfake, salah satu seolah-olah orang yang di video itu adalah orang tersebut, padahal orang lain. Ya. Terus dibuat seolah-olah beliau. Ya. Jadi seolah-olah beliau melakukan kejahatan di video ini. Kalau tidak membayar, dia akan disebarkan. Itu terjadi di pekan, I think berapa hari yang lalu ya. Ya, dalam masih bulan-bulan yang lalu. Itu sangat heboh juga. Tapi kalau biasanya seperti itu. Ya. Tapi most probably in Malaysia, they use the call. Okay, the attacker easily to influence the victim to trust, to believe the information so that they can send the money and so on, get the information.
Okay, jadi
tanya lagi satu lagi nih, legalkah kalau kita isengin keluarga kita sendiri?
Jadi, how if we do some penetration or DDoS, but for our family? Jadi mungkin dia belajar implementation, dokter.
Oh, okay, as I suggested to you, if you know the knowledge, okay, don't become Satan, don't become iblis tadi. kalau ke keluarga sendiri masih bisa dikategorikan ada iblis di dalam hatinya, gitu. Jadi if you want to practice, if you want to implement your knowledge, and as I suggest to you, use multiple computer, okay, for your knowledge. Okay. If you do the for your family, of course your family will suddenly feel sad or maybe feel others thing. Indirectly you make dosa, berdosa. Apalagi itu ke ibu. Ibu dan bapak, oh jangan, tidak boleh, tidak disarankan.
Itu tiba-tiba dikutuk jadi batu, aku tahu. Oke. Jadi memang kita kalau mau latihan pakai multiple ya, istilahnya apa ya, multiple itu tadi ya, apa namanya, computing atau Memang cari yang menyediakan PC-PC yang kita bisa penet ya nanti ya. Kita bisa coba untuk melakukan penetrasi ke sana. Oke. Kalau berkaitan security data tadi kan ada, apakah wajah itu termasuk private information menurut Dr. Verda? Ada satu application di Play Store itu yang ketika kita upload foto kita, kemudian kita bisa berperan jadi orang lain. Ya kan dokter, mungkin pernah lihat aplikasi itu. I'm afraid that itu bisa digunakan for crime. Bisa enggak?
Untuk berubah jadi siapa?
Contohnya, dia tuh ngasih pilihan nih. Ada film A, B, C, D, E. Kalau kamu pengen pura-puranya jadi pemeran itu, gitu kan. Masukkan fotomu.
Just for fun, because you want to make it crime, you have to make it realistic one. Kalau aplikasi itu kan pasti kelihatan pixel, different pixel in between something like gap, something like potongan gambarnya itu enggak. Tapi biasanya untuk fun.
Oh, itu masih aman ya kalau menurut dokter ya.
Tapi if you use it, okay, make it realistic, something like a professional one, something like real one, something like this. I am in front of the UMP, but kalau orang ini kan kalau di analisis, deep analisis, kelihatan ini adalah hanya virtual background. Tapi kalau dibuat apa namanya, ada image processing technique involved in this technique, something that looks real, and then you use it for the a crime, then it belong to the crime. It belong to the police will take you because ini easy ya, just call 911 then police coming. Simple crime in Malaysia they will coming.
Okay, maybe
in Indonesia last question, different.
Last question, dokter, apakah social engineering akan semakin berkembang kreatif dengan kehadiran dunia virtual atau metaverse? Waduh.
Of course, yeah. Due to the pandemic, okay, everyone online. Here, we also online, isn't it? So we conduct online the our webinar today. So if the internet user increase, of course, the social engineering attack will increase, will follow. Okay. Therefore, yeah, we have to mitigate from ourselves, from our family, from our community. Jadi kalau mau melindungi, mau mengurangi social engineering attack, ya dari diri kita sendiri dulu. Kita berubah, jangan jadi setan, jangan jadi ini. Kita tahu caranya, tapi ya kita jangan. Kita punya teman, gitu, tahu dia pandai bikin malware, okay, ya kita nasihati. Tapi kita mulai dari diri sendiri, dari teman dekat dan community. So that one is the way to decrease the social engineering attack.
Okay, thank you. Jadi teman-teman, crime to come from our heart gitu ya, berasal dari dosa, ya kan? Maka perbaiki diri kita, maka semuanya akan jadi lebih indah. Okay, thank you Dr. Verda for your sharing.
Okay.
And next we will go to the next presentation, and the moderator is I will give back to my bestie. Wah. Yang sudah senyum-senyum, sudah tampak gantian segar nih, gitu ya. Oke, okay. Terima kasih Mbak Rona, saya kembalikan ke Mbak Rona. See you, teman-teman.
Oke, okay, terima kasih Mas Satya. Kita akan lanjutkan ke sesi yang kedua. Tadi saya sudah menyebutkan di depan beliau salah satu dosen juga di Universitas Assalamualaikum Yogyakarta, dan beliau memiliki jabatan Vice Rector atau Wakil Rektor for Cooperation and Development of Amicom University. Dan beliau akan membahas tentang deepfake detection. Langsung aja kita sambut Bapak Dr. Arief Setianto. Selamat pagi, Pak Arief. Pak Arief mungkin belum di-unmute, Pak.
Selamat pagi Mbak Rona dan Pak Verda dan teman-teman semua.
Selamat pagi. Apa kabar, Pak Arief?
Baik, alhamdulillah.
Di daerah rumahnya hujan nggak nih, Pak?
Ini aman di sini, belum hujan.
Oh, amin. Baik, Pak ya. Kita akan lanjutkan, Pak, sesi ini. Silahkan waktu dan tempat kita persilahkan untuk Dr. Arief.
Oke. Ya, baik. Terima kasih teman-teman semua. Jadi menarik ya diskusi dengan Pak Firda ini, luar biasa. Banyak informasi baru, insight baru yang kita dapat gitu. Jadi sekarang ternyata kejahatannya makin banyak gitu ya. Crime-nya makin banyak nih. Tapi itu sebetulnya enggak juga ya. Crime-nya itu sama aja sebetulnya. Crime-nya datangnya dari hati ternyata tadi katanya ya. Jadi kita mesti membersihkan hati nih rupanya ya. Oke. Okay. So can I speak Indonesia, English, or both of them, Mbak?
It's okay, Mbak. Fine, ya? Campur tiga, whichever juga. Okay. Bisa. Silakan, Mbak.
Oke. Okay. Well. Let me share my screen. We're gonna talk about deepfake. Yeah, deepfake is one of the new type of crimes. But actually, as many other technology, deepfake can be used for a crime. But also, it can be used for fun or even for something beneficial for human being. So this is a deep fake. In this presentation, I would like actually my interest and my group of research interest is the deep fake detections. Okay, so yeah, this is me. I think everyone already knows, but why I put this picture, because this is part of deep fake. The question is it real or is it fake? Yeah. This is a question for you all. You probably never seen me a couple of years ago, and it might be fake, it might be real. Deep fake actually, an effort to replace some of the video contents into with other video content, but most of the interest of the deepfake creator mostly in this part of the picture, which is in the face, in order to mimic or in order to replace someone's face. So if you never record your, for example, the crime, if you have never record the porn video, then suddenly your face appear in a porn video. This is one of the crime that has been floated a couple of years ago in Reddit. There are a lot of artists. Mostly are women, appear in a porn video, but they actually never been recorded that video. So this is the problem with deepfake. So, but we also have a useful application of deepfake. Last year, we have an application in one of the departments, one of the ministry in Indonesia, with Mas Dani here, I think. So we make an animation for people to answer a question. The video itself has never been exist in the world. For example, when you ask something, then I will answer, but I've never been recorded with the answer and that kind of voice. So this is something useful. Yeah. So The focus of the defect usually in the face, replacing the face of the people in a video. Okay, this is me. It is real. I've never been like that. Yeah. Okay, so the objective for today are two. First, understand what the defect is. The second one is understand how deep learning technique work for detecting the fake or a pristine video. So we work on that. We use a deep learning, but it doesn't mean it not necessarily that detecting a defect has to be used deep learning. We can use other technique. I will discuss later on. Yeah. So by definition, a defect is a technology that can seamlessly stitch anyone in the world into a video or photo that never actually participated in. So for example, I have this picture, and then I put Rona's face in this picture, then but Rona has never been in that positions. Yeah. And I can find Rona face everywhere in the internet, so we can find thousands or hundreds of her photos. So it's stitch the face. There was actually existed for decades. That's how the late actor Paul Walker was resurrected for Fast and Furious 7. Jadi ceritanya dia udah meninggal pada saat syuting, tapi filmnya belum selesai. And then the film was recorded with other people, and then the face of that people is replaced with the Paul Walker face, and then the film's going on as normal because before he died, he was playing that films. So it was useful, and people enjoys the film. Probably, I don't know, you enjoy that film or not. Someone probably yes, but for younger like you, probably not. Mas Satya probably still in his age. Okay. Yes. Defect technologies, new automatic computer graphics. At the time, at the time for Fast and Furious 7, it was taken for about 1 year to stitch the face of Paul Walker's to the films. But currently, with the defect technologies, we can do it in a matter of hour, in a matters of hours. So from about 1 year to in a matters of hour with our normal computer like yours, probably i5, i7, like that. So if you want to make a new film with, if you want to be a film stars, you can download the films and then train with your face, and then your face will appear in the films. Yeah, that's interesting. Yeah, you can be a film stars. Yeah, just replace the face with your face. Yeah. Okay. So the system with machine learning systems, we can synthesize an image and a video or a video much more quickly. So for a video, for 10 minutes, probably we just need 2 hours to make it, to replace all of the face. The other one is, it doesn't mention here in the presentation, instead of the face, they also inject the voice. They can inject the voice. So imagine if, for example, Pak Jokowi has a speech, yeah, and then you change the voice into Jawa, or probably one of you has seen a video of probably English footballer player, and then they speak very Javanese. So they actually working with the lips motion,
So they inject the voice and then synthesize the voice in order to like their original voice, and then make actually an animation, not a real lips movement, but an animation of lips. But we never know. We cannot see clearly with our eyes. Yeah, that it was actually not real. Yeah. Okay. So face, no voice. So two things. Replacing the face, replacing the voice. Okay. In 1997, a paper written by someone, Christoph Pegler and their friends, in this paper, they discussed about how to use machine learning. At the time, 1997, there was no deep learning yet. Yeah, so they used machine learning at the time. And the result of this their work in 1997, you can see here in YouTube. They put in YouTube. It's quite short video. It is about JFK. When they speak, JFK is already not president at the moment. At the moment, that is
Forrest Gump.
It is fake. It is fake, not the real. Yeah, 1997. Yeah, so it's the early development of deepfake. And in 2016 and 2017, there are two papers established deepfakes achievable with a consumer grade hardware. Basically, they want to say your laptops, your PC. Yeah, there are two projects. First one is face to face. It was done in the Germany and the Technical University of Munich, and the synthesizing the Obama project out of the University of Washington. One of the video of Obama is here. Again, it is not a real video. Sorry, it is not a real real Obama. Yeah. It is a fake video. Imagine if you are a president of Indonesia, and then you never say that, okay, everyone in Indonesia will have one car, for example, come from president. So president will buy car for every single every single household, tiap rumah tangga. And as a president, actually you never said that. Yeah, that's gonna be a big political problems. Yeah. Okay, so ini nggak bisa diklik ya. Sebentar, saya coba klik. Right. I'll play the video for you just to have an understanding how harm this gonna be. Oh wait, I'll change the
We present a novel real-time facial reenactment method that works with any commodity webcam. Since our method only uses RGB data for both the source and target actor, we are able to manipulate YouTube videos in real time. Here, we demonstrate our method in a live setup. On the right, a source actor is captured with a standard webcam. This input drives the animation.
So the actor is the guys, actually. The result is the one on the left-hand side.
To previous methods is the re-rendering of the mouth interior.
So you can make not only fake story, but fake, you know, live video.
As we can see, we are able to generate a realistic and convincing reenactment result. Here, we show a close-up of the footage from the previous live reenactment. The input video stream is shown on the left. Note that the target actor is re-rendered in a neutral pose. On the right, we can see the final output of our method.
Okay, so you can see even their mouth movement was, you know,
our system reconstructs and tracks both source and target
mimics by the actor and bring to the target.
Space deprivation transfer technique, transfer the expressions from the source to the target actor. This allows us to obtain a modified face template of the target actor according to the expressions of the source actor. We now re-render the modified face on top of the target sequence in order to replace the original facial expressions.
Okay. Yeah. It's gonna be long. You can watch by your own. Okay. Back to the. Back to the presentation. Okay, you can ask while I'm presenting this. My presentation. So just hands up and start to ask if you want. Okay, so the development of the deepfake is quite fast. So this is the video rewrite 2.0 with a better animation and voice reenactment. Okay, this is the other video. I just skipped this, right? You can access this presentation, so you can just play by yourself. Okay. There are many technologies behind the deepfake. Two of them I write down here. Face to face, real time face capture and reenactment of RGB videos. So it was come from this paper written by Thais in 2016. It was presented in CVPR, so it's quite high rank of computer vision conference. And the second one is the work from Ivan Petrov, Deep Face Lab. You can access the source here. This is the paper, and this is the source. So you can see in a GitHub, you can download it and play with that. So okay. So if anyone want to playing with that kind of things, you can use or borrow their algorithm or put another thing on that. Yeah. Okay, so what is the problem with deepfake? Yeah, this is what I want to raise as a problem. First one is the fact that growing unease that has settled around and evolving deepfake technologies that make it possible to create evidence of scene that never happened. So there are some scene that never happened. Yeah. But you can produce that kind of scenes. What is the problem then? Some celebrities has found themselves unwitting stars of pornographies. Jadi banyak selebriti yang tiba-tiba jadi bintang film pornografi, padahal dia nggak pernah gitu, dia nggak pernah disorting untuk film pornografi itu, ya. Yeah. And politician have turned up in a videos appearing to speak words that they never really said. Jadi kayak tadi ya, tiba-tiba ada video, sebenarnya aslinya video katakanlah Pak Jokowi cerita tentang COVID, tapi kemudian Anda ambil, ya ada orang yang ngambil, kemudian diganti narasinya, suaranya diganti, tapi tetap memakai voice-nya Jokowi, tetapi isinya diganti. That's gonna be a big political problems. Apalagi sekarang orang sering banget ya percaya hoax. Apalagi kalau hoaxnya itu sudah dalam bentuk video. Yeah. People gonna be at least when you know the people doesn't know yet that it is fake, then people gonna trust that. Yeah, in Indonesian case. Yes, yeah, in Indonesian case, there are a lot of fake, not even video, fake narrative, yeah, text. And lots of people believe that, trust that. And it was spread out throughout the social media. Most of them are not criticized. They directly believe that it is a truth because it was come from the internet. Everything in the internet is true. Yeah. Their mind. Yeah, in their minds, in people's mind. And then it's sometime if you remember when we are in a pemilu or general elections, there are a lot of movement was driven by a fake messages. So you can imagine if in 2024, a lot of fake videos, then some political people speak in the public, put in the YouTube, and it's not an actual video, but it was engineered videos. They speak some word that they have never really said, and it can make chaos. So this is the problems. Yeah, and if we do not have a way to avoid this problem, then we'll probably have a big problem in our society. Yeah. Again, if what has Pak Verda said, that if we back to the to the Quran, for example, if everyone get an information, what we need to do? Anyone remember what we need to do if we get an information? What we have to do?
Clarification.
Clarifications. So every time, clarifications. But not many people do that. Even the educated people want. Usually what they did when they get an information, just share to the groups. Share to the groups, and then the people in the groups, you know, complaining and so on and so forth. So this is our problem about the information literacy. Yeah, this is our problem, information literacy. We don't have that kind of you know skill to avoid apa kalau orang bilang di Indonesia kegaduhan. Sering kan kita gaduh ya gara-gara sesuatu yang belum jelas. Yeah. And it is always started from the misinformation. So the big problem with the deepfake is the potential of misinformation, and it's gonna be very strong because it is not just a text, not just a voice, but it is a video. It is a video. Yeah. So this is the problem. So what is our research aim? This is my research aim, and Mas Imam as my group's in deepfake, anti-deepfake research group. The first problems is that the deepfake are a significant threat to society from the development of deep learning technology, which is able to manipulate digital image and video. They are difficult to prove fake. There was a research in 2018 with a human. So we saw, they saw, not my research, they saw a fake image, two people. And you know what? Only 64% of people, maximums, can recognize that it was fake. 34 of them cannot recognize that it is fake. And the at the time, 2018, the technology at the time is not as advanced as what we have now in 2021. Yeah. Jadi di tahun 2018 ya, judul papernya adalah saya lupa ya, judul papernya itu sebentar saya lihat ya biar nggak lupa, nanti teman-teman bisa akses juga. Itu hanya 64% ya orang ya dapat mengenali dengan mata telanjang. Nggak pakai alat ya. Itu gambar fake. Ya, papernya nanti bisa dibaca di Face Forensic Plus Plus. Ya, learning to detect facial image. Jadi fokusnya di face ya, fokusnya di face. Karena kalau diganti face-nya masalah, tapi kalau mungkin diganti latar belakangnya seperti yang Anda lihat di latar belakang saya atau di latar belakang Pak Verda atau Mas Satya tadi, mungkin tidak terlalu masalah. Tapi kalau sekarang yang ngomong saya terus diganti wajahnya Prof. Yanto saja misalnya, itu sudah jadi masalah ya. Oke. Okay. So ini hanya 64% yang dikenali. Jadi kalau tidak dibantu alat, hanya 64% yang dikenali. Itu adalah human performance level-nya. Ya. Itu untuk video yang tidak dikompres. Kalau video yang dikompres, lebih kecil lagi. Ya. So this is it is difficult to prove that it is fake. Ya. Okay. Now, deepfake can be used to commit a criminal act, including spreading fake news, deformations, ya, atau disinformation, revenge porn, and financial fraud. Yeah. This is all of the possible criminals, yeah, possible crimes that we can use, someone can commit with the deepfake video. According to the previous research, it's shown that deepfake video can be detected using the exception net. So in our research, we are going to use the exception net, although I would say that there are probably another algorithm, another deep learning techniques that we can use. Yeah. The previous work has shown a quite good result, but there are some factors affect the accuracy, such as the network architectures, different data sets, frame per video, the number of images that we consider to recognize whether the video is fake or original. So defects detections, besides the defect creators, researchers like me and my research group work on the other side to detect defect video to stop the harm of the defect. There are two possible research streams. There are two possible, I would say there are two different ways to detect the defect. First one is white box, where researchers or the methods aware the defect technique. So there are a lot of defect techniques like FAST++, for example, or other methods. There are a number of different methods, as I mentioned before. So the research in 2016, 2018, 2019, and 1997, they have different technique to stitch the face to the original video. The second one is a black box, where the method do not considering the technique behind the deepfake's creation. We just just see that it is a deepfake and it is real without try to understand how the deepfake has been produced. So the second one, myself call this the black box techniques. Our interest in my research group, we use the black box techniques. We use the black box techniques, so we don't really care whether the video was produced by technique A, B, or C. The only one we know is that it is a fake and it is an original. So what we need to do with that kind of research stream or research method, first the materials, we need the data sets. So we need the data set. There are a number of public data sets, but again, deepfake research is like virus research or internet security research, where every time on the other side, researcher or attacker try to develop their techniques. Okay, so when, for example, I collect the data sets in 2018, 2019, of course, in 2020 and 2021, there are a number of new techniques to produce the deepfake video. So there's probably some of the video produced by the news, the last techniques are not exist in my collections. Then we need to update again and again. So the data sets, the data set need to be updated every time, like virus list, for example. It is the same, the deepfake video list. We need to update every time in order to keep our classifier, our recognizing system work properly for current problems. Second one is available algorithm. There are a lot of different algorithm and a lot of different framework that we can work on it. And some of them work better than other framework. Sometimes it's just because the availability of the data. So we have to play on both of them, the data and also the algorithm, even the modification of the algorithms. So the problem is identify the acceptable algorithms identify the acceptable pre-processing because we need quick. We need some time, we need a real time. For example, when you try to download a video, then we need to understand whether the video that you download from some sources is real or not. Or even when you try to view a video in the in the YouTube, for example, when the streaming is going on, we need a technique, we need a tools to filter which one is the fake video and which one is the original video. So this is the why I put here an acceptable. Sometimes we need high accuracy, we need quite quick or real time implementation and so on and so forth. And the algorithm improvements, again, the techniques or the new technique on defect creation. So like we are in a race. Yeah. This is the data set that we use, but again, there are a number of other data set outside there. So if you make the research next couple of months or couple of years, you will see more data sets available in the research community. So Fast Forensic, for example, they have 5,000 videos, 1,000 is original and 4,000 is fake. CelebDF, only 10% are bot, 10% are fake, real, and then about 5,000 or 6,000 are fake. So the challenge here, as you can see, the imbalanced data sets. Yeah, it is imbalanced. Yeah. 1,000, 5,000. So it is imbalanced. It's going to be a problem. One problem in the classifications classification technique. So we have to deal with that. And the second one is the original data is has a large size, so it will require long computations. This data set comprises of real and sorry, uncompressed and compressed. And compressed one. The uncompressed for 5,000 videos is around 1.2 terabytes. Not gigabytes, yeah, it's terabytes. So it's quite huge. Why? Because it is not compressed. Yeah, we need to do that. The other problem is our solutions resemble using the undersampling technique. Select the number of frames. We test the number of frames. Of course, if you use all of the frames, we will get quite good result. But the question is, if we reduce the number of frames, can I still get a good result? Okay, it is about the data set. The data set is available for public, so you can search, for example, the Fast Forensic Plus or CelebDF Plus. You can without plus plus, sorry, CelebDF. Yeah, you can just download it to your computer. Okay, and we interest on the face only, so we need a pre-processing pipelines. This is the input videos, and then it consists of a number of frames. Yeah, we try to filter the frame that usually do not contain the rich information. So, for example, the first 10 frames, we try to omit it because usually it just, you know, if there are first video, usually the first 10 frame is opening session or something like that. Just, we just filter it out. And then we consider 250 frames only in order to minimize the number of computation, even it's still high. And then from the video, that they might contain face or not in each frame. The frame that contain face will we implement a face detection, we use MTCNN. There are another algorithm like HOG, histogram oriented gradient as well. If you want to implement that, yeah, we use in this research we use MTCNN, but in other research we use histogram oriented gradients. But it was not published yet, so I cannot put in this presentation. And then we cut out. We keep the face only. So this is the face only, yeah. And then we save in the JPEG formats, the crop video, and then we divide it into training, validation, and testing, and then we put in HDF5 in order to reduce the number of data. Okay. The second step is feature extraction. Feature extraction is basically extract the information, the important information from each image. Yeah, each image. Now we use some CNN. We can use some CNN-based deep learning architecture such as AlexNet, VGG, InceptionNet, ResNet, EfficientNet, ExceptionNet, and many more. You can choose whichever you want. But for us, for my research, I use this. We use this in our research, and we interest to employ to extract each frames into a few number of features, say 512 for each frame. Yeah, because in one frame, for example, one frame you have 1024, you will have 1,000,000 pixel, yeah, more than 1,000,000 pixels. If we compute all of them, we will have a problems, because we'll need a huge computation complexity. So we use the CNN-based algorithm to reduce the number of information into a few number. Few mean 512, 265, 505 of array. Yeah? So it's basically like that. Yeah. And this is number 0 and number 511. So imagine that we have 1,000,000, and then we can just reduce the number into 512. So it's going to be very helpful. Once its frame are extracted, and the classifier behind the network are employed to decide whether it is fake or not. So the challenge, do we need to consider all frames? Of course, if you have a very big computer, you have mainframe, you can use all of the frames. But the problem, if you have your own computer, i5, for example, or i7, for example, if you use all of the frames, then it will be takes long times. Can we consider the frame sequence as a time series data, or it just time series mean that the first frame is before the second frame, the second frame is before the third frame, so we can consider that as a time series or not? And what is the access? Can we just select a few number of frames to achieve good conditions? So how many frames is a few? 3? Is it few or 10, probably? So we tested in our research. And then what is the acceptable feature extraction algorithms? We use in our research is ExceptionNet, but it doesn't mean that it is the best. You can choose other CNN algorithm, as I mentioned in previous frames, to get the best feature extraction algorithm toward the better accuracy. What is the classifier with is acceptable for a good recognition rate? Yeah, there's a lot of classifier, and we can choose one of them. Can we use transfer learning? Probably yes, probably not. So what is the entire framework? I just let it nothing here because I want to just drawing here. So this is the video. You have some frames here. And then each frame, we can use extractor here. For example, in my case, it is exception net. Exception net. So you extract everything here, every frame, you extract every frame here. Yeah. I use here exception net. Yeah. The name of algorithm, and then you will get the extraction result. Yeah, it's basically an array of number. Yeah, in my case, I use this is the second frame again. You have 512, and the third frame you have 512. Suppose we have three frames. If you have 250 frames, then you have to extract 250 times. And then if you consider that as not a time series, then you can we can menyambung. What you call it, menyambung? Just leave it. Yeah. So you have three frames. You have number zero and number 1536. Yeah. And then you will use this. Yeah. As an input of classifier here. You have a lot of option here, yeah, for the classifier. You can use for example, a simple algorithm like naive bias, for example. Yeah, naive bias, for example, here, or you can use SVM, for example, here, and then the final output is fake or not fake. Just two alternatives. Yeah, if you find fake, then it is fake. Yeah, here in our case, we use ANN here. We use ANN. So this is the entire framework we have been done, and you have another option actually, and we did it in my research group. I didn't do that yet, which is treat that feature as a time series data. So we can use like an algorithm like here. You can use LSTM, for example, yeah, or by LSTM, yeah, or RNN, yeah. So we have a lot of opportunity here to change the entire framework. Okay, so in our experience, I use have a video here, but we only consider 3, 5, and 10, and then we have a stack of exception net here. And then we have a feature here. And then we mix all together into one. And then we use supra layer of ANN here, and in the final one is the result. So this basically an artificial neural network. We call it a fully connected layer. Yeah, we use a fully connected. Yeah. We test, what we test here, the number of frames. The question is, does the number of frames affect the quality of recognitions or the recognition rate? The second one is the number of layer. In the last fully connected layer, we use one layer, two layer, and three layers. And we test whether the thickness of the fully connected layer in the end of the network affect the accuracy or the recognition rate. And this is the result. We use two different two data sets. We use face forensics and we use celeb data. So celeb DF. So we have this, and then we test the number of frames between 2, 5, 7, and 10. Yeah, and then we see the result here. Okay, according to the number of FPV frame per video, 2 frame per video, you get the blue one, the accuracy at the blue one, and then this is the loss. Sorry, this is the loss, and this is the okay. This is the validation. The recognition rate. Higher the recognition rate, better it is. So I will just see the validation of the different number of frames on the face forensic video. So this is the green one. Yeah, the green one, you can see the maximum achievement is at about 85%. The blue one is 2 frames. So out of 250 frames, we only choose 2. Therefore, it's going to be very quick. Yeah. The problem is with a quick computation, the result only achieve less than 70%. So 7 out of 10 video predicted right. Yeah. And then when we use 5, you can see the result is about 89%. So it's gonna consider as a good result. On the right hand side, we test again a different number of FPV in a modified exception net. What is the modification we did? The exception net here is fine, but we modified this. The thickness of the classifier. So the baseline, there are no hidden layer here. They just use this data and then input to the final the final classifier. In the modified one, we put one additional layer here. In the modified second, we put 2 additional layer here. And then as we can see, with more layer, we can see that the result basically quite better. You can see the number after that. Yeah, this is the number, sir. This we have a baseline without additional layer, and then this is the one with one additional layer. What happened here, if you can see here, if you have without additional layer, the maximum achievement is on the test 88.78. And with one additional layer, the result getting worse. And with the slope data set, as we can see, the validation test get the higher achievement at 90%. So 90% right. So this is our result. And we still work on that. You can see I cannot play the media here, so let me change the presentation to another one. So this is our result, and you can see on the right hand side for Donald Trump's. This is a fake Donald Trump's. Can you see the fake mark on the or the red one? We use red and blue, so the red one means that it is detected as fake, and the other one is detected as right. Okay, you can see our paper here in the IEEE Explorer is already published. This is the real video for the second example. So this is our conclusion in the paper, written in the paper. And currently we still work in this area for improving the current results. Okay, but Rona, I think that's all from me. If anyone wants to share their question, feel free to do so.
Okay, thank you so much, Mr. Arif, to sharing knowledge with us, ya. Luar biasa menarik sekali, Pak Arif. Apalagi we know in the social media there's a lot of application that bring us like kita tuh bisa using this deepfake as a entertainment thing. And how about your opinion, Mr. Arif? As we know kita hidup di generasi saat ini, dan kita tuh kadang aware not aware what we upload, what we kita unggah di dalam our social media, even in our kita tuh kadang aware unaware. Sebenarnya it's secure or not secure. And how about your opinion? And maybe you can give us kayak kita kalau mungkin ngomongin range umur yang sekarang bisa tahu ya, ah ini editan, ah ini bukan gitu. Tapi kadang saya di grup keluarga sendiri pun, even itu cuman kayak editan, ada kemarin sempat geger masalah lubang gitu, ada orang jalan, terus dia masuk, padahal itu kan cuma main cutting aja ya Pak. Itu aja di grup keluarga tuh ngiranya itu beneran, seriously kayak jangan sampai sepelekan hal ini gitu, banyak yang ternyata kayak gini berbahaya gitu. Ya kan saya jadi kayak, wow, it's really, really, jangan sekarang kayak jadi trust issues, apapun itu yang di-share, kita harus benar-benar make sure is it real or not, and maybe you can give advice or maybe kasih, Pak, pandangan untuk generasi sekarang, gimana cara kita menghadapi kemajuan teknologi ini, Pak?
Yeah, thank you. It is interesting to speak. Because right now when the technology is moving forward and then it's quite quick, and then people in the social life usually left behind. Even the law law or order in certain countries is not actually catch up with the technology development. That's the problem. For example, when you capture something and then you modify a little bit thing on that, and then people are unaware that it's actually a misinformation. And the problem is it is suddenly viral, and then people think that it is true, it is truth, and it is actually not. That's going to be a problem, and our law is not, even in the law says that we are not allowed to not allowed to disseminate wrong information. But the problem is, what is the enforcement? If we use our eyes, even your very simple technique with manual editing, for example, we don't even understand whether it is actual or it is not actual. So that's the problem. So what is our job? What is our task? And is the young generation, especially you guys as a computer mania, computer guys, as an informatic guys, we need to battle this with the technology as well.
Okay.
If we think that people will be aware of that, there is no guarantee. There's no guarantee. So this is our job, because all of you know the technology. All of you know that there are a lot of things out there in the world, people doing something probably improper. Probably they do it just for fun, or they do it for economical reasons, or even they do it for political reasons. It probably happened. So it's going to be your role, our role, to stop that, to stop the crime. And it cannot be done in a usual way. We have to do it with the technology as well. So that's my point. Thank you.
Okay, so maybe your research juga mengambil topik itu kah, Pak, untuk battle the crime itu, atau just for learning about that deep fake more deep again?
Gimana maksudnya?
Ya, untuk penelitian selanjutnya, apakah kita tuh harus kayak belajar untuk memerangi itu dengan teknologi juga gitu ya, Pak, ya?
Ya, yeah, sure.
Atau sekarang udah ada belum sih, Pak?
Yang saya lakukan di riset ini, kita menghasilkan satu detektor begini. Satu detektor yang tadi saya share di presentasi, ya. Now we got around 95% right. Hanya untuk video yang sudah ada contohnya, gitu. Sebenarnya di dataset. Problemnya adalah di luar sana, di sisi yang lain, teman-teman kita yang mempelajari, memproduksi video fake itu juga bergerak terus gitu. Mereka kan nggak berhenti.
Iya, betul.
Ya, sehingga ke depan ini akan menjadi live research topics, ya. Karena setiap saat akan ada tantangan baru, dan saya pikir kita mesti berbagi peran. Teman-teman yang memang tertarik untuk bicara soal security, kalau dulu kan security itu bicaranya apa yang tadi disampaikan Pak Firda misalnya tentang serangan malware, kemudian DDoS, serangan ke server gitu ya. Sekarang serangannya bukan lagi, kalau itu kan serangan dari B2B atau C2B ya. Sekarang itu serangannya bisa C2C gitu. citizen to citizen gitu. Citizen to citizen, jadi saya bikin video, saya kirimin kan, misalnya tadi saya lihat Satya lagi gandengan sama istrinya, kemudian wajah istrinya saya ganti wajahnya Rona gitu kan, itu kan udah perang dunia kedua kan. Nah, itu bisa terjadi situasi gitu. Nah itu citizen to citizen kan, sehingga ini akan menjadi satu topik riset yang terus menerus, dan itu menjadi kewajiban kita semua untuk menyediakan obatnya lah ya. Kalau ini dokter ya, kalau ada penyakit baru obatnya mesti baru gitu.
Iya, ini nyambung juga sama pertanyaan dari Abian Fauzi Widihasani ya. Is there a method for real time fake detection? Jadi ada nggak pak?
Is there a method for real time fake detection? Say yes, we are currently working for that.
Okay.
We are currently working for that. Jadi kita sekarang semuanya sedang menuju ke sana. But again, the problem is last year 2020 defect itu masih di wajah ya, wajah yang resolusinya itu masih 256x256. Sekarang itu di 2021 ini wajahnya udah bisa 512x512. You can imagine ke depan itu wajahnya akan semakin, wajah yang diganti ini akan semakin detail gitu. Jadi semakin sulit untuk di detect. Ya. So silakan, ini adalah ruang terbuka teman-teman untuk riset. Dan ini kejar-kejaran kayak orang bikin antivirus ya, anti defect.
Oke, jadi siapa tahu nanti udah jadi ya Pak ya, nanti bisa dipraktekkan, digunakan untuk orang banyak juga. Karena saya rasa walaupun kita we are not a public figure, tetap our data is important ya Pak ya. Apalagi our face and everything. Kayak tadi Mas Satya bilang bahkan bisa juga buat pinjol gitu kan. Itu kan juga bisa untuk yaitu citizen to citizen. Nah, it's a lot of crime in this world, bahkan di dunia maya juga sangat mengerikan. Apakah ada polisinya juga Pak kalau di dunia maya, misal ada yang melakukan seperti itu tapi just for entertaining. Between kalau ngomongin law tadi yang belum strong enough gitu kan Pak. Kalau as a friend gitu, misalnya kita ngedit-ngedit muka orang, iseng gitu. Apakah is that a crime too? Or asal orangnya nggak marah, it's okay?
In terms of law, we still lack of undang-undang perlindungan data pribadi ya, GDPR ya. General Public law of kalau di Eropa namanya GDPR. Kita masih berdebat soal itu. Tetapi di undang-undang ITE sendiri sebetulnya sudah ada undang-undang untuk transaksi elektronik itu, salah satunya adalah menidakbolehkan kita untuk menyebarkan data pribadi orang lain tanpa seizin ada pemiliknya. Nah, itu. Tapi apakah delik itu yang akan dipakai atau tidak, itu sangat tergantung pada para pihak yang berseteru ya. Karena kan di kita kan menganut masalah hukum itu kan ada namanya delik aduan ya. Jadi kalau tadi saya ngedit fotonya videonya Mas Satya gandengan sama istrinya, saya ganti sama Rona, kemudian tidak ada aduan, maka selesai. Ya, namanya delik aduan. Yang kedua, kalau dihukum kan ada yang bukan delik aduan, tapi polisi bisa langsung bergerak untuk melakukan itu, untuk melakukan penegakan hukum. Nah ini, to be honest, saya bukan orang law ya, jadi keterangan saya mungkin salah, tetapi ada persoalan-persoalan hukum yang di kita belum ada aturannya, termasuk soal deepfake ini. Secara detail, belum ada. Termasuk misalnya begini, kalau bapak ibu ada di mall, kemudian di mall itu kan ada ini ada apa namanya CCTV ya, yeah. Ada nggak sih aturan bahwa kita boleh menolak di CCTV gitu?
Ya, yeah, betul. Yeah.
Padahal kan itu wajah-wajah kita, bukan wajah mereka loh. Jadi ini kan copyright ya. Wajah saya jelek-jelek begini, ini copyrightnya Arif Setianto gitu. Tapi ketika misalnya satu saat ada seseorang yang mengambil wajah saya, kemudian menampilkan di tempat lain tanpa izin saya, dan itu sering terjadi, ya tiba-tiba foto saya muncul di kalender Amikom itu tanpa concern dari saya, itu itu problem ya. Itu. Oke. Okay. Ya, yeah. Ya, yeah, thank you Pak Verda ya, Pak Verda gonna leave, that's okay, ya. Yeah. Jadi itu masalah dan itu belum ada aturannya. Nah, di beberapa negara seperti di Amerika ada beberapa aturan di negara bagian yang memang sudah secara tegas membolehkan atau tidak membolehkan sesuatu pengambilan data pribadi itu dilakukan, gitu. Seperti di Inggris misalnya ketika ada di sekolah mau ngambil foto anak untuk digunakan untuk promosi, ya maka kita diberikan consent, ya itu ada klausul di GDPR, jadi apa namanya undang-undang pelindungan data pribadi itu. Nah, in our case ya di kasus kita di Indonesia, people still like to you know to show themselves in the public area, in the public. Ya, yeah, and then we used to unaware on that. Ya, yeah, jadi kalau ada foto-foto kan tiba-tiba ada yang numpang gitu kan. Ya. Yeah. Nah, sampai-sampai kita nggak punya aturan loh ya. Kalau Anda punya kamera itu kameranya bisa bunyi, bisa nggak bunyi kan? Sehingga kadang-kadang di kelas yeah. itu ada mahasiswi-mahasiswi itu ngambil foto saya dan saya nggak tahu karena nggak ada aturan bahwa kamera itu nggak boleh nggak bunyi. Jadi kalau cekrik gitu. Yeah. Di negara-negara tertentu kamera, pengambilan kamera itu harus bunyi dan harus izin. Nah itu hal-hal yeah. seperti itu kita belum aware dan juga aturan hukumnya mungkin belum ada. Kalaupun ada biasanya kita akan memakai local wisdom, biasanya boleh-boleh aja. Makanya boleh-boleh yeah. kadang-kadang bingung. Kita kok pada suka foto-foto sama mereka gitu. Jadi itu yang juga mungkin nanti bisa jadi perhatian teman-teman di humas untuk mulai memperhatikan ketika kita mau memasang foto seseorang itu salah satunya mungkin kalau orang Indonesia nggak perlu concern, tapi kalau bukan orang Indonesia we need concern from the people who are going to be shown in the certain materials. Oke.
Okay. Oke, Mbak. Terima kasih atas jawabannya. Dan ternyata tidak terasa waktunya sudah sampai jam 11, berarti di Malaysia sudah jam 12 ya. Dan waktunya sudah selesai sayang sekali, dan teman-teman di sini jangan lupa untuk presensi di link yang ada di chat Zoom. Dan terima kasih sekali lagi untuk Dr. Verda dan Dr. Arif sudah sharing knowledge dengan kita semuanya. Dan tadi yang leave duluan Mr. Kusnawi. Terima kasih Pak Kusnawi juga sudah join dengan kita. Dan yang di Zoom bisa nonton ini lagi, jadi jangan takut ketinggalan ilmunya. Ini kita ada live stream di YouTube Amikom Jogja, jadi bisa ditonton lagi ya. Terima kasih untuk seluruh peserta yang sudah join. Terima kasih Mas Satya. Mungkin Mas Satya ada ini pembelaan? Oh enggak. Ya, terima kasih. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Sampai ketemu di acara selanjutnya. Dadah.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Terima kasih Dr. Verda, Pak Arif.
Ya, wassalamualaikum.
Terima kasih Pak Verda.
Terima kasih Dr. Verda. Salam untuk dosen-dosen di UMC.
People, how they compete each other.
For years, Amikom has tried to make a suitable place for their students to feel more enjoyment in their learning process. We believe that learning is not something that the students should do, but it should be something that they want to do. That's why we always support everything that relates to creative and fun learning activities. It is the essential idea of creativity, associating fun and learning all together.
One thing that I love about this university is that they allow us to experiment and try to make new things. It's okay to make mistakes and learn from them. So that's why they built so many facilities, labs, and also they have professional companies. We called it Professional Lab. We can experience what it is like to be in the real industry, what we need to be, the attitude, the skills, and everything that makes us valuable out there. It's like we are well prepared for something big.
When I first got here, I was completely full of worries. Not because of entering a new phase, but about the future. I wasn't sure of what I was supposed to do at that time. But it turns out that everybody does the same. And Amicom made it easier for me. Everybody supports each other. The lecturers, staffs, employees, and all of my friends, they are so lovely. We have sport activities and great facilities. The cafeteria is clean and neat. And the food, they are delicious. We are like coming into a big family.
If you are a person that is afraid of things, I recommend you to come here to feel the atmosphere.
Enjoy the fun with the combination of nature, the city, and romance.
Join us and let this place reflect the best of you.
Come on, join Universitas Amicom Yogyakarta.